Good morning. Welcome to Calvary Lutheran here on this beautiful fall day. I got the signal. It's time to stop chatting and to get worshiping. So that's what we do here on Calvary Lutheran at 10 o'clock in the mornings on here in this space, but also online. And I wanted to start making the announcement that we are going to start transitioning our online format and streaming from Facebook to YouTube in the next couple of weeks. I will be publishing some things in our Thursday email, as well as putting it up on Facebook. We will, I think, enjoy the YouTube experience more than our Facebook, which oftentimes gets muted when it shouldn't be getting muted. We do have the licensing for it. But anyway, I just want to give you a heads up. Look for that an announcement in the near future about our changing streaming platforms. It will still be on Facebook, but it will be a link to the YouTube video that we will be streaming from. So heads up on that. There's quite a bit of other things coming up here in our church calendar. But before we get to the Sundays to come, let's talk about this Sunday. Let's talk about these beautiful quilts that are on the pews this morning. Every year we send quite a few of these quilts to Lutheran World Relief, which sends these quilts all throughout the world. A couple years ago, you might have heard about the big explosion in the port of, was it Lebanon? Beirut, thank you, in Beirut. Well, that's where a lot of our LWR quilts were being held. And we thought we lost them all. I mean, thousands and thousands of quilts. Carol was sharing with me this story, and she is our chief quilter, and she has probably a way better story to tell, but this is what I heard. For a year or so, we didn't know if those quilts were going to be distributed after all that work throughout the world to the people in need, but they found underneath all the rubble that the boxes they found all the quilts underneath the rubble unharmed. And so we have tens of thousands of quilts, maybe even more, that are also being distributed again when we thought we lost them all. So added to those, that amazing story and all those many quilts that are, again, being shared throughout the world, we have 68. Is that correct, Carol? 68 quilts here on the pews today. And these quilts, again, they go to many different places. When I went to Mexico City and I was living with a host family there, I actually slept in a bed with a LWR quilt as my blanket. And I was so comforted knowing how many churches and stuff put in the work and effort to make sure people stay safe and warm at night. So today we're going to bless them. And you're sitting on probably one, and in front of you is probably another. If you will think about the one that you're sitting on and also place your hand on the one in front of you, we will bless these quilts this morning together and remember and give thanks for all the hard work of our quilters here and for the ministry of Lutheran World Relief. Where did my blessing go? There. Gracious God, as we place our hands on these quilts, we join giver and receiver, recognizing the unity of all your people in the body of Christ. We celebrate being the children of God. We give thanks for the variety of gifts that compose these quilts, donations of fabric, thread, and sewing machines, the faithful people who cut the squares, design the patterns, sew the tops, iron the fabric, make backs and fillers, tie and stitch the bindings, provide publicity, donate boxes, pack the quilts, bring food to sustain the quilters, and contribute the money for shipping these quilts throughout the world. We give thanks for the fellowship of all who work together to make the quilts, the laughter, the shared stories, the joy of crafting something with one's hands and heart for another, and the time to reflect and wonder about the recipient.
We send these quilts as a sign of God's love and blessing for each person who receives one, trusting that their quilt will be a source of comfort and hope in the midst of disaster and fear, a symbol of Christ's love. We ask that you bless the fruits of our labor and the whole mission of Lutheran World Relief and Calvary Lutheran Church here in Morganton, that together we may minister to our neighbors in need. Bless all who give and all who receive, as we are sown together in the unity of your Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
So enjoy those quilts this morning, and we will, at the end of service, if you will stick around for a little bit and help the quilters pack these quilts up, we need them stacked on at the end of each pew. Is that correct? Okay, all right. So if a few of you are willing to help take them down to Mission Hall, that would be very helpful. That's the room directly below us. If you're not available to do that, please take the quilt that you've been resting on and just bring it to the end of the pew on your way out. Okay, many other things to share today. Last evening we had a... Oh, you want to... Yeah, you should. Come here. I'm not going to do a good job of it. All right, Pastor Lauren.
So last night we had our first youth lock-in in forever, and it was so much fun. We had a great time together. We also gathered around our theme of Let Your Light So Shine Before Others, and one of the things that we did was we carved pumpkins, and then at our Vespers, our evening kind of devotion time last night, we used some little flameless candles as part of that, talking about our light shining, and those candles are now in their pumpkins, and they are downstairs. In the fellowship hall, so if you would like to go see them before you leave today, please go see them. It was a lot of fun. I want to thank a couple people for a lot of support, especially Beth Spahn, who was my faithful sidekick last night through the whole night, and then she went and taught Godly Play this morning, so thank you, Beth. and then also Craig Spahn and Catherine Wolfner showed up this morning early with breakfast for us, so that was amazing, and we thank you for that. And just thank you all for your support, again, ongoing with the youth. I think we had a really good time together last night. We learned a little. We laughed a lot. Watched a good movie and slept a little bit. So thank you for your support, and yay for you.
I did have a little bit of a quieter confirmation class than usual today. But... Reformation Sunday, that's something we do in the Lutheran Church, and guess what? That's next week. So as we do celebrate the Reformation of 502 years of it, or something like that, please wear red and stay after worship and join us in the fellowship hall, as we also will be celebrating new members coming into Calvary Lutheran, and we will be celebrating the confirmations, or rather the affirmation of baptism, of four of our confirmation students who have been going through the pandemic and through these past 2 years all the classes that we have for confirmation to affirm their faith and to share and articulate why they believe what they believe. So it's going to be a very wonderful Sunday. Wear red. We're going to have the bell choir also performing, and I don't know if performing is the right thing, but sharing, adding to worship. But we will also be having the Sunday school children doing a divine, what's it called? Liturgical dance. That sacred dance. I knew it was a good word. I appreciate all of you. Thank you for giving me the words when I stumble over them. Sacred dance will be on this coming Sunday. I'm really looking forward to it. The following Sunday is All Saints Sunday. If you have a loved one who has passed away since last year's All Saints Sunday, always the first Sunday in November, and would like to have their name read during our remembrance this year, please be sure to write their names and date of death either on the Google Doc provided in the Thursday email, on our website under the News tab, or in the binder located in the narthex right in the back over there. Names need to be provided by Wednesday, November 2nd. Stewardship is, as we've been ongoing with that that campaign, in your bulletin should be an estimate of giving card. Please fill that out and share it with in the offering or with Judy online.
That is hugely helpful for us as we try to prepare our budget for the coming year. And our annual meeting will be on November 13th, the Sunday after All Saints. Whew. I think there's a few more announcements here, but I think I need to cut them short because we've already gone too long this morning. So let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship by listening to the prelude. Will the congregation please rise and face the baptismal font for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who is eager to forgive and who loves us beyond our days. Amen. Dear friends, together let us acknowledge our failure to love this world as Jesus does. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. Turn us in a new direction. Show us the path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength on the journey. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven, and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Holy God, our righteous judge, daily your mercy surprises us with everlasting forgiveness. Strengthen our hope in you, and grant that all the peoples of the earth may find their glory in you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Our word is perfect. What does it mean to be perfect? If something's perfect, Francie.
Like, to not have a single problem.
No problems in it, okay. It's really good. No faults at all. Yeah. So it's great to get a perfect on our papers from our teachers, right? That's what we want. But can we be perfect in our behaviors? Perfect is hard to do, isn't it? We make mistakes, don't we? And it's okay.
Well, I got a perfect grade on my spelling test without studying.
That's pretty good. Yeah, that's perfect. But our behavior-wise, let's talk that way. Can we be perfect in every single thing we do? No, and it's okay. And God wants us to recognize that it's okay not to be perfect, but we can still try, right? Try hard to do it every time, right? And if we make a mistake, we should learn from it, right? Yeah, if parents tell us not to do something and we do it anyway, right? Sometimes what we learn from our mistakes is we learn it better than, you know, just somebody telling us all the time, right? So sometimes we have to make mistakes to learn from. But that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to learn from our mistakes and own up to the fact that we're not perfect, right? And in our gospel reading, you hear about this one guy that goes around talking about how he has no sin. And to go around trying to tell people that he is sin-free and that he always lives a sin-free life, he's trying to tell people he's perfect, right? And that's not true, is it? Now, God says, you know, it's okay to be a sinner. In fact, he says, for all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. For those that own up to their mistakes, they find more favor in the Lord. In fact, when you come in every day, we've already done it today, we do something called the confession and forgiveness. We say, God, we made mistakes. And then Pastor Paul says, you know what? You are beloved children of God. Your mistakes are forgiven. And doesn't that make you feel better? Yeah. So just knowing that we are going to make mistakes, right? And that we can learn from our mistakes doesn't mean we shouldn't ever try to not make them, right? It just means to try harder sometimes, right? But even when we make mistakes, God still loves us. Isn't that pretty cool, isn't it? It doesn't matter what you do, God still loves you. He wants you to try better next time, right? But he still loves us. And that's pretty awesome, isn't it? Can you say a prayer with me? Dear God, thank you so much for your love. Even when I make mistakes, knowing that you love me helps me want to do better. Thank you for always loving me no matter what. Amen. Thank you.
first reading is from Jeremiah. Although our iniquities testify against us, act, O Lord, for your name's sake. Our apostasies indeed are many, and we have sinned against you. O hope of Israel, its Savior in time of trouble, why should you be like a stranger in the land, like a traveler turning aside for the night? Why should you be like someone confused, like a mighty warrior who cannot give help? Yet you, O Lord, are in the midst of us, and we are called by your name. Do not forsake us. Thus says the Lord concerning this people. Truly they have loved to wander. They have not restrained their feet. Therefore the Lord does not accept them. Now he will remember their iniquity and punish their sins. Have you completely rejected Judah? Does your heart loathe Zion? Why have you struck us down so that there is no healing for us? We look for peace, but find no good. For a time of healing, but there is terror instead. We acknowledge our weaknesses, O Lord, the iniquity of our ancestors, for we have sinned against you. Do not spurn us for your name's sake. Do not dishonor your glorious throne. Remember and do not break your covenant with us. Can any idols of the nations bring rain, or can the heavens give showers? Is it not you, O Lord our God? We set our hope on you, for it is you who do all this. Word of life, word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading is from 2 Timothy. As for me, I'm already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which is the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. At my first offense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you're able for the reading of the Gospel according to St. Luke, the 18th chapter. Jesus also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. So our gospel for today sets up an easy trap for us to fall into. It starts off almost like a familiar joke or one of those "there's two kinds of people" quotes. I'm sure you've heard quotes like that before, quotes like from Bill Murray and What About Bob? There's two kinds of people, those who like Neil Diamond and those who don't. Or like the one that goes, there's two kinds of people in this world, those who walk into a room and say, here I am, and those who walk into a room and say, oh, there you are. Some of these are quite hilarious, actually. If you couldn't tell, I've had a good time looking them up. So just for fun, here are a few more. This is one I have memorized after a family member once made a bunch of two kinds of people quotes at a family gathering a few years back. It goes like this. There are two kinds of people in this world. People who believe there are just two kinds of people in this world, and people who don't. And here's one from C.S. Lewis that I think will actually help us get back on track for the sermon. At least it's about God and prayer. He says, there are two kinds of people in this world. Those who say to God, thy will be done. And those who say, all right then, have it your way. The thing about these kinds of quotes is that they are not really quotes, are they? To be more accurate, they are judgments. They are labels and names that we use to categorize certain people as other or different from ourselves. And this is the trap that is set just by the format of the parable itself. I mean, it is literally titled after two kinds of people, the Pharisee and the tax collector. This parable is such a simple story that we hardly even have to hear it to understand it, especially for those of us who have familiar ourselves with the Gospels and Jesus' use of parables, as well as just like judging others, which I feel like we all get a lesson in throughout life, especially in middle school. Anyway, throughout the summer and fall, we've heard plenty of them. We heard the ones about the Good Samaritan and the 10 lepers, just to name a couple that lift up the outsider over and above the insiders. And we've heard in nearly every story that mentions them how the Pharisees were the enemies of Jesus, supposedly. So just by hearing the title of this parable, which bears the names of its two main characters, we could probably accurately guess, without much effort at all, who's going to come out on top. The Pharisee and the tax collector. I wonder. After 2,000 plus years of sermons and sharing the story of Christ, the name Pharisee has taken on some seriously negative connotations. If you ever find yourself in a theological debate, I can't think of a worse name to call or be called than a Pharisee. So synonymous has that label become with the direct enemies of Christ that I would rather be called a heretic before being called a Pharisee. At least heretics have a long history of interesting and challenging thought on their side and a chance for repentance. Pharisees, however, don't even seem to get a chance at all these days. So clearly has the line been drawn between their flawed understanding of God and the ministry of Jesus that nothing seems it could bridge the gap. The definition of a Pharisee in the dictionary itself exposes the modern understanding of the term. In the dictionary and in our own minds these days, a Pharisee is supremely legalistic and a self-righteous person. In short, a hypocrite. And so again, right off the bat, we know what's happening in this parable just by the two kinds of people we hear that are involved. Jesus is taking on his favorite punching bag, right? The Pharisees, yet again, are going to go down. The problem is, however, as soon as we hear the Pharisees being named and make that assumed judgment and labeling of characters in the Bible, in the biblical story, we find ourselves missing the point completely. It's what happens when we, like we so often do, put too much stock in names and labels. The Pharisee, as he stood in the temple praying, valued his names and labels for other people greatly. They helped him measure how well he was doing compared to others. He prayed, "God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector." When I hear that prayer, I just can't help but imagine the Pharisee praying out loud, not looking up to heaven so much, but more to the side with a narrow-eyed, almost cartoonish glance at those around him. So concerned is he with his own status over and above others who are such blatant sinners, they can't help but have their sin exposed to all, that he pays no attention to his own status before God. His own self-righteousness and pious acts have assured him of his holiness, and at this point in time, he isn't even in need of God. To the Pharisee, his understanding of living right with God seems to follow the lines of that old camping adage. When you run into a bear in the woods, don't worry about being faster than the bear. Just worry about being faster than the slowest person in your party. Or in more theological terms, according to the Pharisees, when it comes to sin, don't worry about being fully blameless in the eyes of God. Just worry about being less sinful than your neighbor. This thinking is no doubt cause for much sideways glancing when you're praying. Like in a track race, if you feel you're ahead of everyone else, you have to look to the side or even all the way to your rear to see just how far behind everyone is. Labels and names like thieves, rogues, adulterers, and tax collectors help you place others on the podium below you. The more blatant they are in their sin, the easier it is. Tax collectors in particular are fun to point out. They were no doubt all crooked, stealing money for themselves while at the same time betraying their own people, God's own people, to foreign rulers. They were like the mafia bosses of their day. I could see the Pharisee enjoying himself greatly while he prayed. After all, he wasn't actually in need of anything from God. So busy was he at glancing sideways and placing himself in front of greater sinners than he, it could hardly be said he was even praying to God. What a perfect description of a Pharisee, right? Doesn't he fit exactly those self-righteous, hypocritical people we all have glanced sideways at and pointed out in our lives, maybe even in our own churches? I certainly have some favorite denominations I like to look sideways at. Some folks who like the prosperity gospel, some televangelists who get a little carried away. It's easy for me to say, at least I'm not like them, preaching like that. God doesn't want that. God wants what I do, preaching off a manuscript with my head down like this. See, this is exactly the trap I was talking about in the beginning of my sermon. Like the tax collector in Jesus' day, the Pharisees are those whom we know for certain believe and act just like Pharisees,
often become our favorite sinners to point out and exalt ourselves above. When we read this parable and think to ourselves, thank God we pray like the tax collector does and not like those stinking Pharisees do, we find ourselves in the exact same trap Jesus had set up for those who trusted in themselves as being righteous and regarded anyone, even Pharisees, with contempt. The message of Christ is not about righteousness. It's about justification. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. This means that it doesn't matter how much faster you can run than those around you. The bear is going to get you too. We are all sinners, and the cost of sin is death. That is the law. For those who are blatant sinners, like the tax collector in our gospel for today, or any of those other folks with labels that are usually attached to themselves in our news headlines, thieves, rogues, adulterers, just to name a few, for those blatant sinners whose sin is really not made public in one way or another, the law is very real. They are confronted with it throughout society on a daily basis. Its effects are often visible and easy to point out even. The consequences of those sins are even more so, and the labels are just so easy. They jump to through our mouths like without even thinking. But that is not the justice that God is about. God does not seek out punitive justice for those who cry out for mercy. As Lutherans, quoting the Apostle Paul, will say, we are justified by grace through faith. And what is grace, if not mercy, for those who trust in God enough to cry out for such forgiveness and new life? What is grace, if not mercy, for those who feel the shame and lift up their heads to the heavens, asking for mercy? Jesus ends his parable with a powerful truth. Those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves shall be exalted. This is why we hear in Micah 6:8 that what is required of us is to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. There is nothing we can do to exalt ourselves. Doing so has the exact opposite effect, in fact. The life God has created us for is not a competition. It is not a race to get to God ahead of all others. When we read in 2 Timothy the author saying, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith, the author is not celebrating and defeating all others and placing first. He is simply celebrating in his completion of the race, of his perseverance in the fight, despite the many blows he may have taken, in his keeping of the faith. Prayer is our language of faith. Trust in God to grant the mercy, grace, and forgiveness we are all so desperately in need of when we go to God in prayer. Seek justice, and you will be given it. Our Lord is a merciful Lord. Look up to heaven for justification, not side to side. Give up the measuring sticks, the labels, and all the name-calling that only serves to make others out of those God specifically puts in our lives for a relationship. There's a powerful book that we are reading as a synod right now. It's about refugees and immigrants. The title is itself a proclamation. The title is, They Are Us. When they are us, there's no more sideways looking. When they are us, there's no more two kinds of people in this world. We, though many, so many we cannot even count, are made one in Christ. We are all children of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In gratitude and humility, let us join together in prayer on behalf of all of God's creation. God of mercy, you are in the midst of us, and we are called by your name. Inspire your church to serve and love all people with the unceasing grace you extend to us. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all creation, you formed a world where even the sparrow finds a home. Preserve the beauty and diversity of all creatures with whom we share the earth. Lead us to protect all living things. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of peace, you are an ever-present help in the times of trouble. Rescue families and nations from torn apart by violence and warfare. Unite all people toward common goals of reconciliation and peace for every person. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of hope, you stand with the suffering and give strength. Comfort your people filled with fear or anger, anxiety or shame. Bring healing to all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit, especially Catherine Gamewell, Tom Mills, and those that we pray for now out loud and silently in our hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of restoration, you call on us to trust in you and not ourselves alone. Make this congregation a community of humility and repentance, ready to encounter you in love and follow in your ways. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of eternal life, to you be the glory forever. We give you thanks for all you have fought, all who have fought the good fight, finished the race, kept the faith, and now live with you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Becky, do we have a hand?
All right.
Peace be with you all. Sorry for giving you so many sidelines.
Thank you.
Please rise as you are able. Our service continues with the offering prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, in your great love, you richly provide for our needs. Make of these gifts a banquet of blessing, and make us ready to share with all in need, through Jesus Christ, who sets a table for all. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
You are holy, you are whole, you are always evermore than we ever understand. You are always at hand. Blessed are you coming near. Blessed are you coming here to your church in wine and bread, raised from soil, raised from dead.
Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ invites you to this table. Come, taste and see. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Please rise as you are able and receive the blessings of our Lord. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. God of the abundant table, you have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road that we might serve our neighbors with joy for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Sunday school going. You've been reading it, right? Thank you for doing that.